This is a download from Rutland Radio.
Hello, and thank you for downloading the Rutland Radio podcast from rutlandradio.co.uk. This is where you can hear the best bits from the last week.
Thank you, Steve. I'm here with Miranda Krestovnikov and your second bird fair. But, I mean, what an incredible event just to have on our doorstep here.
I know, it's amazing. And you consider the number of people who are here and actually how far afield some of these people have come. I mean, I've driven from Bristol to be here, but some people have come from Scotland and Cornwall and even the other side of the world to be here in Rutland. And then actually, we were just discussing, weren't we, the relatively small impact it seems to have on the area.
Yeah, I mean, apart from obviously trying to get a room, that's about the only real reason that you'd realise.
Yeah, I think we reserved our room back in April or something. Yeah. But no, it's brilliant. It's become a bit of a highlight of the year for us now. I think we're sort of now organising our summer holidays around Bird Fair so we can make sure that we can be here now, which is great. And I'm here with the family. The kids, instead of moaning about coming to Bird Fair, actually said, oh yeah, can we come along again, please? So they were clearly excited. And then I said, oh, actually, we've got Steve Backshaw here. So we've heard him twice. So Steve was last night, Saturday night, and he's just been on this morning as well, which is brilliant. I mean, he's just inspiring the next generation of naturalists. So that was very brilliant having him there. And yeah, it's a wonderful networking event. It's a wonderful just getting together of all sorts of different naturalists. It's not just birds as well. And that's, I think, the thing about bird fairs. People think, oh, it's just going to be lots of birdie people sort of hanging around with their binoculars. But it really isn't
which
like that.
Which there are lots, but at the same time.
But there's so much variety here. It's incredible.
And congratulations on your presidency of the RSPB. I mean,
thank you.
The RSPB, you know, is I mean, not quite a partner here, but it's not far off, is it?
Yeah, we're a major part of what happens at Bird Fair, and it's obviously we've got 1.2 million members in the RSPB now, which is fantastic. So it's really good that we're very well represented here, and obviously always looking for new members. And a wonderful organisation for me to be involved in. I mean, it's been fantastic for me and for the family. My children have got really, really involved in a lot of the different RSPB campaigns and sort of projects that have been running as well. So, yeah, I've got another couple of years to enjoy my presidency. So looking forward to that.
Miranda, thanks very much for joining us here at Bird Fair this weekend.
Pleasure.
Just even looking at your eyes, it's so special, isn't it, to be here?
You know, I'm always excited. It's great.
Special,
I can't control
though.
It's wonderful. I mean, nature is a wonderful thing. We just need to spend a bit more time out there.
Rutland Radio.
Thank you, Steve. Well, the amount of people actually when we come to Bird Fair say, have you seen Bill Oddie yet? And yes, we have. The first photo I saw of Bill Oddie was actually in Stocks yesterday.
Was it? Yeah, they must have some competition I don't know about. Did I get ticked off? They got a nice spy book, you know, they can get me and Chris and Nick and Steve and the usual suspects, you know. Oh yes, I've got a complete set.
Yes.
And you win a trip to Slimbridge or something.
Now, can we talk Twitter? Because you put on Twitter earlier in the week that you're asked to do Celebrity Big Brother, humongous amount of money, but you couldn't because it's Rutland Bird Fair weekend.
Yeah, all that in a sense is true. I've decided not to knock things like that, you know, because, come on, they're doing a show, and by whatever criteria it is, I guess it's a good show, or I don't know, but, you know, I haven't watched any old Big Brother since the first 2 or 3 years when it was new. But I'll tell you something, the sort of money that is involved in that is catastrophically high, I mean, and I'm sure in some cases it may make you go, oh, all right then, I'll take a chance for whatever comes. But no, I can't do that. I've been asked to do all virtually the reality shows of one type and another. I was proudest actually of being asked to go along for a sort of audition for The Voice, which I watch and I think it's not a bad show at all. And
are you a singer?
Yeah, I have been.
Of course. Yeah, of course. What am I talking about? The goodies. And yeah,
Please don't quote the Funky Gibbon. I don't count that as singing, really. But I went along and actually did a sort of unaccompanied audition and then got a letter saying, oh, they'd like you to come back again. And by then, unfortunately, either myself or my family, that's the trouble, you see. I've got three daughters and a wife. Two wives, in a way, because my first one, although we're quite long divorced, are still good friends. So I can ask for an opinion, you see, on that thing. And the funniest one was Strictly Come Dancing, which, again, I had no intention of doing. And people can't understand that because they love it, you know, and it's just not my thing at all, you know. I've always hated ballroom dancing. I don't like the music. And I thought, oh, I see, you just want me to be the little fat one who has to wear a stupid costume, do you? Well, no. But I had to run that past the family panel, And my middle daughter, Bonnie, is a dance teacher and was a very good dancer, actually. And we got to her and said, what's your opinion? And she just said, it'll kill you.
That was the end of that.
So that was the end of that. I took her advice.
Tell us about your book that you're signing here this weekend. This is a slight departure, isn't it?
It is, yes. It's called Tales of a Ludicrous Bird Gardener. Now, I know it sounds like I'm whinging. I personally would not have put bird in there, but the publishers insisted. They say, you know, that's what sells, that people just look and see the word bird.
And Bill Oddie. Like, Bill Oddie,
well,
and Bird,
maybe,
on the same.
But, you know, why not Bill Oddie and Ludicrous? I think that's far more reasonable, really. It isn't, therefore, about, and the petunias look good that year, anything like that. It might be I managed to get off with that girl from college, but...
You know, it's tales of your gardens through the years.
Yes, it is, basically, yes. You put it so well.
Bill Oddie, thanks for joining us on Rutland Radio here, Rutland Water, thank yet
you.
Again.
Thank you. It's very nice to be here. I couldn't get here last year. And I did miss it, and I do feel very back at home, you know, to a certain extent.
Yeah. Highlights from the past 7 days, the Rutland Radio Podcast.
So, Tim, could you sum up this weekend? And we're just hearing Steve Backshaw just finish here on his very, very first birthday.
Yeah, it's been a phenomenal weekend. I cannot ever remember the comments we're getting back from people, exhibitors, volunteers, the actual exhibitors themselves. It's just been phenomenal. It's just buzz, buzz, buzz all weekend. We've had, as you know, the sort of wildlife celebrities here in huge numbers again, you know, clapping Steve Backshaw. He came last night. Loads of kids last night. And the front five rows at the moment are just full of children who just obviously love Steve. And I know now he's going to go off and do some book signing. But, you know, that's just all part of an incredible 3 days. We've probably had 25,000 people. We haven't done the figures yet, but it's just been rammed from day one, and the weather's been kind to us, so I mean it's just one of those wonderful days, you know, or weekends we can remember, that, you know, as we build up to our 30th and thinking, wow, if every weekend could be like this, you know, conservation would be the winner worldwide.
And do you actually think about next year, you know, as you're going around this weekend thinking, actually, well, we must do that next year?
I think one of the great things about Bird Fair, and I'm sure you talk to anybody who's involved in this sort of business, it's all about networking. You know, you can sell anything on the stand, but, you know, it's how you do the business afterwards and, you know, who you're meeting. Yeah, I've been networking all weekend, talking about the 30th year. Not quite the 31st yet, but, yeah, I mean, talking to our celebrities, you know, what would you like to do next year? Because, of course, all the celebrities that come to Bird Fair, you know, they come on their own accord. We don't sort of pay them, or, you know, attendance fees or anything like that. They come because they love Bird Fair. So Bill Odd is just about to come on stage. Then it's Mike Dilger from The One Show. Miranda from The One Show was on just a few minutes ago. David Lindo, the opener. And there's Bill Oddie. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of Bill Oddie, but he's walking past at the moment. And Bill's doing an amazing event about his new book, The Ludicrous Garden Birdwatcher. So, you know, Bill will be here this afternoon. So anyone who wants to come and meet Bill, you know, come along to the show at Eggleton. Just come and experience Bird Fair if you're a local folk.
Rutland Radio.
Thank you, Steve. And we've been talking this afternoon about how Bird Fair is so much the place really to bring the family if you're into wildlife. Now Steve Backshall is the big name this weekend, I think, above all the others? I don't know, there's so many names. I'm here with Helen Glover, of course, who's married to Steve, and you've been cycling around the area. You've been here since last night?
Yeah, we came yesterday and Steve did a talk last night, and so this morning I thought I'd take advantage of being in such a beautiful place. We brought our bikes, and so I've been cycling around the lakes, and it's stunning.
Now, most recently, you were probably on TV with that kayak challenge over, 26 hours, something like that?
Yeah, it was a big challenge, and it was only sort of an Easter time. I feel like we're still recovering from it. It was a double kayak with Steve. We did the Devizes to Westminster race, 125 miles, and it was to raise money for the Wild Land Trust. So we wanted to raise an area of rainforest in Borneo, and it was sort of a big task. A lot of money needed to be raised, and so we knew we had to do something big. We put a lot of work into making sure people were aware of it, were on board, were, you know, we did lots of school talks and public speaking events and really tried to raise awareness of it, and we were really blown away by the support that we had, actually.
Now, your Olympic career has just been phenomenal in such, for us, kind of, it seems like quite a short time.
I mean, it feels like a short time for me as well. it's one of those things. I mean, I started rowing when I was 21, and before that I was really sporty. I was into running and hockey and things like that. But yeah, even for me, it feels like a short period of time, because, you know, within 8 to 10 years, I had gone to 2 Olympics from starting from scratch at the age of 21. And okay, it felt like a long time when I was there on the rowing machine at 7 in the morning for, you know, hours felt like days. But, you know, when I look back, I think actually life has changed a lot in a short period of time.
Thanks so much for joining us here in Rutland. It's fabulous to see you here at Birdfest.
Well, it's amazing to be here. It's something that Steve and I have always spoken about getting ourselves to, and finally we find ourselves in the country at the same time, at the time of Birdfest.
We're like, that must be, you know, quite a challenge, really, because, you know, Tim Appleton, who has been speaking to Steve to try and get him here for so long, he said he hasn't had a day off in, like, months.
Honestly, it's rare. This is a rare occurrence. And so we were just thinking, right, this is the weekend we have to block out, because we've always wanted to come here. And even just looking around and wandering around, I think you can see where it's going from strength to strength. And I kind of wish everybody the best of luck in the world, and hope that the 30th year next year is even bigger and better than this year.
Helen Glover, thanks for joining us on Rutland Radio.
Thank you.
Rutland Radio's best bids on the podcast.
Thank you, Steve. I'm here with Steve Backshaw, first Bird Fair. And speaking to your wife, Helen, earlier, she said you've been trying to get here for years. You've been trying to marry up your diaries, and here you are.
Yeah, exactly. It seems to be the time of the year when I'm always off on expeditions. And so I've been invited many times, but never been able to come down. And I wish I'd been before. It's so much fun.
And last night, the first 5 rows of your talk were children, hands up wanting to know what you discovered, you know, what was the most amazing thing you'd ever seen, and you were talking about things, you know, in your own garden.
Yeah, I think it's really important that, you know, I get the opportunity to go to far-flung exotic places and see extraordinary spectacles from around the world. But the things that we have in our own backyard are definitely the most important, apart from anything else, because it's up to us. It's our responsibility to protect them and take care of them. And I think it's really important that young people know that. Not everyone has the privileges that I have of being able to, you know, travel all around the world, but you can have a big adventure right here. And, you know, certainly where we're standing right now, we're surrounded by stunning British countryside, amazing wildlife, and it's really important that the youngsters know that this is very special.
You spent a week in Alaska on TV recently. What an amazing, you know, window on the world you're able to do. You think, you know, maybe Sir David Attenborough's done all this in a way through his long and varied career. But doing those kind of programmes just takes it to another level.
Well, I think the beauty about live television is that it is unpredictable, that no one knows what's going to happen next. And also that you are showing a window in time on an actual moment, on something that's happening then and there. And because of that, you can't fake it. And there's an honesty that people really warm to. You know, the big, what we call blue chip natural history programs, maybe 4 years in the making, and you're picking the very, very best of that. When it's live, you're seeing an actual moment in time, and people respond really well to that. It's kind of the difference between watching the highlights package of a sports game or watching it live. Obviously, there is always the concern that something might not turn up and you might be looking at a completely blank scenery, but we got very lucky and we had bears and wolves and whales all live, and that's fantastic.
And finally, could you sum up Bird Fair and your impression of it, you know, for the first time here?
Bird Fair is about like-minded people getting together, making big plans, planning expeditions and adventures, learning about new parts of the world that they can go off and see wildlife. And it's not just about birds. That's absolutely quintessential about Bird Fair, is it's about nature. It's about, you know, I've seen people here who are really into their bugs and into their reptiles. It's not just about birds, but it's somewhere where you can learn so much, get so many ideas. It's absolutely brilliant, and I will be back.
Steve Backshall, thanks for joining us on Rutland Radio. It's really fab to have you here.
Thank you very much. You're very welcome. Nice to meet you.
Rutland Radio.
Jane Micklethwaite.
And we're here to talk about Preston and the third lead theft that you've had in how long?
In 4 years.
Now, people will probably remember these pictures from a few months ago on social media, and literally that the flat part of the church was completely stripped, just left as wood, wasn't it?
Yes. It was a very professional operation. We think the thieves were probably the same lot as had been there before, but they managed to disable the alarm, disable the security lights, get up on the roof, take all this lead down, get back across a stone wall, two timber fences, a paddock, and a gate with a double lock on it, and off and away before anybody heard or knew anything at all.
So how much lead and how much was it worth?
It was the main part of the church, the central body of the church, virtually almost all of that. And to replace it, and we have to put something other than lead, obviously, on it, because the lead might walk again. Mm. But to replace it and generally get it done as we want it done and as how the diocese likes us to get it done, there's going to be very little change out of £20,000, which is a heck of a lot of money to raise in a village the size of Preston.
It is indeed. And, you know, if you think of the ongoing restoration that you need to put into a historic building like that in the first place, you really don't need setbacks like this.
No, and we'd like to do something to the heating, which we desperately need to renew, but paying for this is going to set all that back a long way, so we really are desperate to raise the money as soon as possible and get on with it.
Now, you'd like people to join you in a car boot sale on Bank Holiday Monday.
Well, it's all started because a much loved senior resident of the village died, and her family very kindly said that anything that they did not wish to keep out of the house could be sold for the church. And so we started off with that, and from that we grew to having a car boot sale, which will be on Bank Holiday Monday, starting at 10 o'clock in the morning until 3 o'clock. And anybody who wishes to have a space with their car to sell anything, it's £5. Other than that, the entry is £1 a car or 50p per person.
And would you like people to book in advance? Just
no, we've done none of that. We're dead unprofessional, I'm afraid, because we've never done it before. So we're just waiting for people to roll up on the day. And we hope that lots of buyers and sellers will come, because we hope we're going to have some interesting things to sell. And we hope it'll be a lovely sunny day. And we look forward to seeing everyone. There will be refreshments in the village hall.
So I guess this is the first of many fundraisers, really, to
yes,
get the replacement for the lead.
It will be. We had a hog race the other day, but we're going to have to keep at it. We're having a concert in October, but it's going to be a non-stop performance, I think. And so we would be very grateful if anybody can come, even if they just want to have a look round and a nice walk round on a sunny day, we hope.
Let's hope so. It's Bank Holiday Monday, the 28th of August, which of course is just a few days from now, 10 until 3 at Church Lane, Preston. If you'd like to sell your wares or indeed go browse and buy, please do support Preston Church in its continuing fundraising to get that replacement roof.
The weekly Rutland Radio Podcast.
If you can start at the beginning of your weekend. I mean, what a weekend it was. What basically happened? Your wife went into labour quite quickly.
Yeah, so, we went to sleep normal time on Friday night, and then about 2 o'clock in the morning on Saturday, she woke me up and said, I've got a really bad stomach ache. And I said, oh, okay. And she says, I'm just going to go to the bathroom. And then she went to the bathroom, and then 5 minutes later she came back into the bedroom and got back into bed and said everything's okay. And then she squeezed my hand, and I noticed that was a really strong contraction.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, oh, that's a really, really strong one. And I thought, well, when's the best time to phone the hospital? You know, because the last birth with our daughter, you know, it was about 8 hours.
Yeah.
So I was, so let me have a look on Google when's the best time to phone the ambulance, to phone the hospital.
I'm so with you, because I went through this back in March, so I know exactly what you mean, yeah.
Yeah, so it says to monitor for an hour, that the contraction should be 5 minutes apart and they should last for roughly a minute, and that's when you need to phone the hospital.
Yeah.
So the first contraction lasted for a minute, and then I timed in between, and it was 5 minutes and 30 seconds. I thought, like, that's very close. And then after that, it came down to 4 minutes, and then 3 minutes. I've really got to start rushing now.
And how fast is this all happening then? The contractions getting close together. Is this just literally minute by minute?
Literally, the first contraction was five minutes apart. Then it was 4 minutes,
right.
And then it was 3 minutes. So literally, she just came on at about 2:05.
Mm-hmm. So you then phoned the hospital, and what did they say?
Well, I tried to phone the hospital. I tried phoning Peterborough Hospital 6 times and I couldn't get through to them. So I just had a message saying that the midwives are busy, call back later.
Right.
So naturally I was in absolute panic at that one, because I was, what's going on? You know, what am I going to do? So I phoned my mother-in-law, and she managed to get round really quickly. And Becky was in the bathroom at this point. And I'm still downstairs trying to phone the hospital, not getting through. And you know, we had our 4-year-old daughter in bed as well at the same time, worried about what was going on. So, you know, my head was all over the place. And then literally, Becky's mum, she said to me, you need to phone an ambulance. So at that point, I phoned the ambulance. And this was about 2:30.
Wow, this is like half an hour where this has all happened so far.
Yeah, so this is within half an hour. Yeah, so I phoned the ambulance, and the woman on the phone was saying to me, you know, is she breathing? I said, yeah, no, she's in labour, and I gave all the details of this is how far the contractions are going and how far apart they are. And Becky's at this point screaming really loud, and she then asking me questions, you know, well, when's her date of birth? And I was in the way of having a four-way conversation, one with Becky screaming, her mum saying she's doing this, the woman on the phone saying get towels. So I'm going, date of birth is towels. No, it's not towels. I was getting confused. And then literally I looked out the window within 5 minutes and I could see the ambulance down the bottom. So I ran out. I literally ran out the front door. And I ran out to him, pointing to my house, saying they're up there. So I came back in the house, and then Becky's mum shouted, the head's come in.
Oh, wow.
I shouted down to the ambulance guys, you know, the head's come in. They come darting into the house. I ran all the way upstairs into the bathroom, and they looked at Becky, and they just said, right, you know, next contraction, push, and he's out.
Oh.
And they literally did that, and she did that with no pain relief, no epidural, no gas and air, you know, just literally pushed him out.
There'll be a lot of mums who are so jealous listening to this morning.
Yes. the whole thing was literally that from the moment her first contraction started, it was 50 minutes.
That's unbelievable. So what would you like to say? Because the reason that we found out about your experience was the ambulance service had actually, you know, put a picture up. So what would you like to say on the radio to anyone who helped you?
Well, what I'd like to say is, I think to Stephen and Pete, to the ambulance guys, they were just the most professional, caring. They were unbelievable. They literally, you know, we can't express how grateful we are to them. You know, in the time when you're trying to phone Peterborough Hospital and they're going, you know, they're not answering, and we'd had a bit of a traumatic experience with all of this through the pregnancy. Anyway, I mean, Becky had about 9 different midwives because every time they've kept leaving. So, you know, we were a bit, you know, what do we do? You know, we're left in the lurch. And these guys came in and they were literally just like knights in shining armour. They really were. You know, they were there, they were caring for her, you know, and to top it all off, you know, they got a bit emotional themselves and saying, you know, this is the first ever baby they've delivered.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm getting emotional. I'm back with you. You know, when my wife gave birth to our little one back in March, I'm here. I'm there with you totally. So, you know, I mean, for our experience, it was slow. We got plenty of time to get to hospital. This all literally happened within the space of 50 minutes.
Yeah, so, within 50 minutes. Yeah. So after this point, thankfully, as I say, Becky's mother was here. So after the umbilical cord stopped pulsating, yeah, I cut the cord, which they let me do.
Yeah.
And we passed baby Angus over to Becky's mum, and then I was with her while we were waiting for, you know, for this placenta to come out. And then at this point, then obviously the Stephen and Pete says, you know, we need to get you to hospital because obviously you need all your checks doing. And they tried phoning Peterborough Hospital, and they were given the response of, she can't come here, we're full.
Yeah, they do close just for like an hour sometimes, don't they?
Yeah.
Just because they're so full.
The hospital we had to go was Hinchinbrook.
Yeah.
But yeah, again, I was, you know, I was a bit miffed at Peterborough Hospital for that. But after going to Hinchinbrook, I'm unbelievably happy with how well we were treated at Hinchinbrook.
It's all part of the same family now, isn't it? So
yeah, that's it. You know, they were a fantastic hospital as well. But Stephen and Pete and, you know, the East Midlands Ambulance Service, they were just absolutely the bee's knees. They, you know, you could not fault them. They were fantastic.
So how's baby Angus doing now then, just a few days on?
Yeah, he's doing very well. He's having lots of feed. He's already decided that the normal milk isn't good enough for him and he needs the hungrier one.
Excellent stuff. Well, thank you very much for sharing your experience with us, Tom.
And no, no problem.
So it's Becky, is she your wife?
Yes, she is.
And you should give your daughter a mention as well, who's been through all this with you at 4 years old.
Yes, yeah. So yeah, it was a little Poppy. You know, she was she absolutely loves her new little brother. She loves him to pieces. But I don't know. To be honest, if the ambulance people hadn't have made it, I don't know how I could have potentially delivered him or done anything like that. So in a way, I want to say a massive thanks to them, because when he came out, the umbilical cord was wrapped around his neck. So in a way, Stephen and Pete, they saved my son's life. So and my wife in some aspect, because you never know what could go wrong.
Thank you so much for sharing your story with us here on Rutland Radio, and congratulations on your new arrival in your house. Thank you.
No problem at all. Thank you.
Rutland Radio.
This weekend, I had a go at the park run at Rutland Water. So the park run, it happens every week at Rutland Water, also at different places all over the country. And I did it with local YouTuber Claire Maxted.
There's green grass, blue skies, sheep are running away from us as we speak as we run along this path alongside Rutland Water to our left. It's beautiful. There's so many people here today as well. Yeah. I'm really surprised at how many people. Is this like a weekly thing? Yes, parkrun happens at 9 o'clock in the morning every Saturday at various locations across the UK. So the Rutland Water one's really, really popular.
You're proper into your running, and you've got your own running club, haven't you?
Yeah, I set up a group locally, and it's called Stamford Trail and Ultra Running Club. So it's just a club for anyone who's interested in running off-road to get together and run together, maybe go to the Peak District, do some trails there, explore the local area and see what trails are on offer around Rutland and Stamford area. So past 1k, and the backs of my legs are feeling quite heavy. Yeah. Got a bit of a... I can feel the stitch brewing.
Oh no.
Which side? In my left. Oh. Just keep breathing into that stitch. Imagine where it is, and just breathe into it, like with a nice deep breath. So keep breathing.
Good advice from Claire there. Just keep breathing into that stitch. Oh my gosh, stitch and achy legs after 1 kilometre. Oh dear, it was really tough, especially if you're like me and you don't like running that much and you don't run that often. But did I make it the whole way round? I could have walked away from the park run on Saturday morning, but I didn't. I went and I had a go at the 5k park run around Rutland Water, but did I make it the whole way round?
Running past Lawrence and Church on the park run at Rutland Water. Oh my gosh, 5k. Been jogging it with Claire Maxted, and I'm literally coming up to the finish line now, going through the blue cones. Here we go. Finish. 1, 2, 3. Yay! Thank you. When Claire said to me, do you want to do the park run? I thought, okay, I'll give it a go. Not going to get far. And I've done it. I've managed to jog the whole 5K. It's taken about 45 minutes-ish, but I can work on it next time, can't I? Next park run I do, I can work on beating that time. My legs kind of feel like jelly, but I did it. Thank you, Claire.
That's the happy bell that you can ding once you've done it. I can't believe it. I managed to run it. I managed to get around the whole 5K. 5 kilometres, which is about 3 miles. I came 250th out of 277. Took about 40 minutes, but you know what? I did it. And it's just a race for anyone. There are people there pushing along pushchairs. There was someone walking with Nordic walking sticks. So you don't have to run it. You can walk it if you fancy it. And it happens every Saturday morning, 9 o'clock at Normanton, Rutland Water, if you ever fancy having a go. I would say give it a go, because you feel so good once you've done it.
Highlights from the past 7 days, the Rutland Radio Podcast.
How would you describe your relationship with the Tailcoats first off, Sarah?
So I'm a sailing friend of the Tailcoats, and actually have known Steve, the father, for over 25 years. We were at university together, and we all sailed together at Rutland Radio, and our children have grown up together.
At Rutland Water?
At Rutland Water, yep. Rutland Water Sailing Club, yep.
So Just having seen these pictures of Ben and the fact that his eye is you know, it's protruding out of his head at the moment. There's something serious going on there.
Yes, you're absolutely correct. There is a tumour in the muscle behind his eye. It's a very rare form of cancer, and we now need to get that removed and the area treated.
Now, you launched fundraising for this on Wednesday. You've already got 2/3 of the money, but you need it quickly, don't you? Presumably, this is life-threatening for Ben.
You're right. Every second counts for Ben, and we really need to hit the date for this operation, September the 4th. The NHS have been simply incredible, but they can't offer this specific operation. And this is the one that his NHS medical team believe will make the real difference to his future. So we're going full out to try and raise that money so we can still have this operation early September.
So the NHS have said, yes, it's absolutely the right thing for him, but we just don't have the money.
It's actually not a procedure they offer. So they've recommended it, but it's not part of the NHS regime of something they offer. They are going to review the funding later in September and this decision. However, that's too late. Every day matters, and we really need to hit this timing, if possible, of early September.
Tell us about his sporting achievements. I mean, as I say, I've seen him quite a few times at the Active Rutland Sports Awards.
He's a great all-rounder in terms of sport and crazy about it. You'll also see him in triathlons, so that's running, swimming and biking. And he's a very active sailor locally. He took part in what is effectively the World Championships almost for team racing earlier this year when he was feeling better and was the youngest by many, many years taking part. He was actually selected to go out to Bermuda to sail as part of the America's Cup, as part of the, it's called an Open Vic, part of a sort of youth program. But unfortunately, his illness meant he had to pass that on to another local Rutland friend. So he's a very talented sportsman, but also charming with it and great at supporting younger kids and helping them along with their sporting ambitions.
So you've got 2/3 of the money you need, which was raised in 2 days. How would you feel if you logged on at the end of the bank holiday weekend and it was all there?
I think there would be huge whoops of excitement all over Rutland, Leicestershire, Northamptonshire and Cambridgeshire. There are a fantastic family, and Ben deserves every chance to get this operation as soon as he can, and we would all be ecstatic. Of course we would.
And if he doesn't get the operation, if the money isn't raised?
Well, do you know what? We're just going full on to raise the money any way we can. To be frank, in this kind of area, there isn't really a plan B.
Sarah Camp, thanks for joining us on Rutland Radio. So if people search for Ben Tilecote on GoFundMe.com, that's the easiest way to actually pledge any money they can.
Thank you so much.
Rutland Radio.
It's Ian Scott. I'm the organiser of the Burley sponsored ride.
And the Burley itself has been going, what, 55 years, something like that? I guess the sponsored ride is a bit newer than that.
Yeah, we came up with the idea about 96 and got permission from Burley then. We then ran it alternate years until about 2007. And since then, we've managed consecutive years right up to now. So I think that makes it around 16 or 17 times.
This is the cross-country course, basically, that people can take a look around.
Yeah, the first thing is you've got to have a horse. And then, yes, you get to ride around about half the course in the areas which are away from the main event on the Sunday morning, which is about 15 of the 30 or so fences.
Now, you take people off in waves. They can go in groups of friends or teams if they want to, but everyone basically has a set time.
Yeah, once they've entered, they get a confirmation letter, and then they get allocated into groups of about half an hour. Maybe 60, 65 in a group, but they can be all staggered out over that half hour. So they get a start time, and then off they go onto the course.
Now, this is all to raise money for charity, well, a number of different charities. Mm.
Yeah, principally equine charities and local charities through Stamford Ex-Tablers, so it's split between the two. And Burley Horse Trials also have a donation from the proceeds, which also goes to equine charities as well.
So how do people enter? Because they've literally got hours to do that.
Yes, it's burleysponsoredride.co.uk for online entries. You won't manage a postal entry now because we're just about full. And yeah, we close tonight.
So people presumably have to, if they have a horse, they have to come up with their horse box and park all that up.
Yeah, they have a dedicated entrance to keep us out of the big traffic problems you sometimes get with the horse trials. Then we've got our own parking area with loos and refreshments and photographers, and our sponsors, SEIB, are there with their goodie bags and everything. So we're self-contained up at the top end of the horse trials up by the Cotsmore Leap, and then people can go down into the horse trials at the pedestrian day rate.
You say you're nearly full. About how many people actually do this?
We go to 500 normally. We're slightly over that at the moment, Rob, but we sometimes get some no-shows as well for various reasons. So we're taking up to 520.
It must feel a real privilege, the fact that this has all been designed for the UK's top equestrian stars, and actually you get to be right up close.
Yeah, you should see the smiles. I mean, it is great. You can take your old horse or young pony, tiny pony, huge horses. We've had even shire horses ridden round, right up to the fences, have a look at them. You can go for a paddle through the trout hatchery. It is great fun, and people come back absolutely bubbling with it. It's great, and they get their photograph taken down by the lake, and then they go off on some tracks around Burley Estate, which brings them eventually back to the start.
Is there a minimum age for this?
Yeah, it's 5 and over, and if they're 12 and under, they have to have an adult riding with them.
It must be a very special thing for anyone who's into horses.
I think so. And also, every year we manage to get 100% of the proceeds to charity, because we get a sponsor, which is the SEIB, to pay for our expenses. So 100% of the entry fee and 100% of their sponsor money goes to charity. And we get some lovely prizes for those that have raised the most sponsor money.
So that's burleysponsoredride.co.uk, but do it very quickly if you'd like to take part.
Absolutely, yes, please.
Highlights from the past 7 days, the Rutland Radio Podcast.
Stacey Lattishaw before that on Rico Iglesias' new song. I'm here at UCC just looking at a sea of students here at the maths block with the outgoing principal of UCC, Jan Turner. Is this the last day you'll actually ever be here?
It is, yes. So it's an absolutely brilliant way to conclude, I have to say, because it's just amazing. The students have done so well. I'm really, really happy. We've got such a scattering of nine, which I'm very, very pleased about.
Because this is the maths and English
the maths and English new grade, yes, because nobody really knew how that was going to sort of pan out. But we've got so many students that have come out with nines that I'm absolutely over the moon, really, really delighted.
What will be your lasting memories of actually being here for, what, 11 years?
10, yeah, well, yes, yeah, so it's 10 full years. Mm. I think days like this, really, where you can see all the students, all the parents, everybody's just so happy with the outcomes and the successes of all the hard work they've put in, and the staff are here as well, and everybody just feels like one sort of big family congratulating each other, so it's fantastic.
And what will students typically do from here? Because, of course, they've got to be in education or apprenticeship until 18.
Yeah, there's a real mixture. We've always had more than 75% students that go on to do study A-levels. They all go on to study at some institution or other. So this year we've got a real mixture of Harrington, Bishop Stopford, QE, King's, New College Stamford. They are going off to a variety of different places. And we've got a significant number as well that have got apprenticeships. So everybody's secure in where they need to go next.
Jan Turner, Principal of UCC. Thanks for joining us on Rutland Radio. This will be the final interview we'll ever do.
Yes, it will. I know. But thanks very much indeed. And thank you as well for all the support that the radio gives to the school, because I know that you've been very helpful in promoting lots of things that we've done over the years. Thank you very much.
Rutland Radio.
Okay, I'm here with some of the UCC students who are your names.
And Jahan Chen.
Catherine Booth.
How did you do, and how have you found the new grading and stuff? Has that made a difference?
It was mainly just a bit more of a worry, because none of us really knew what we were going to get, because we didn't have any grade boundaries. The papers were all new. They were a lot harder than before, but I'm really, really happy what I got. I don't really know how I got it, to be completely honest, but I am really, really happy what I got, and I think, despite everyone being really worried, I think it's paid off. It hasn't been as bad as we thought it would be.
And what about the stuff that you actually get here, the yearbook and the mug? Is, you know, it's nice to have some free gifts, isn't it? I've never seen that actually handed out before on results day.
Yeah, it's like a memory, like in maybe like 10 years time, we can just looking at it and then look at everyone you have been with.
So everyone really is has got a sort of profile in there and everything.
Yeah, everyone's got a profile in there, and you can see a picture from when they were like 11 years old to when they were 16, so it's really funny to see like the difference between people and how they've changed. And then you do like a quote and your favorite moment, and it's a really nice like memorabilia, and it's quite embarrassing as well.
Yeah, it's 5 years is a long time in secondary school, isn't it?
Yeah, especially if you had a bad haircut when you were 11.
So whereabouts are you both going to after this?
I'm going to QE, which is in Leicester.
I'm going to QE, Leicester as well.
So what do you both hope to do ultimately?
Biology, chemistry, ancient history.
And I'm doing accounting, business, graphic design. So.
Very best of luck. Thanks for joining us on Rutland Radio. Happy results day.
Thank you.
Rutland Radio.
It's Rutland Radio, so it's GCSE results day. I'm here with Principal of Campus College, Stuart Williams. Now, changes in grading this year for some subjects, but not all subjects. How do you actually then crunch the numbers when you put your statistics together?
That's such a good question. With great difficulty, we've got a great bit of software actually that does it for us. But even then, we've had to tweak things to make it work across the two different systems. But no, we've got there.
Now, we hear all the hustle and bustle in the background. This is just at the start of those picking up their results. A lot of smiling faces, a lot of people jumping up and down. Is that the way you've seen things?
Yeah, it's been a great morning so far. And we obviously have had a good look at the results already, and we're extremely pleased, and so will our students be. Some of our best results we've ever had, actually. 80% get those English and maths grades. I mean, what has been a really tricky year with the new course, the new grading system. So, no, extremely pleased.
And what happens to your students next? Obviously, you've got Harrington next door.
Yeah, Harrington desk is here, and that's looking very busy already this morning. We're expecting a bumper year for Harrington students, but I've just been chatting to students off to Melton Vale. We'll have students go to college, chat to another lad who's at Mars doing an engineering course. We've worked really hard to make sure they're going to the right places, so they're going to be successful, and now they've got the great grades to be able to do that.
Have you got anything else to add so far this morning?
We've had a really, really successful top end this year. We've got 20 students who've got 8 A's or A stars. We've got about 40 who've got 5 A's or A stars. So really well set up to go on to do A level. A lot of them going on to Harrington, obviously, but then also to a few other places. So
that's a staggering result, isn't it? When, you know, you're a school for everyone in the county, and Rutland traditionally has that success rating always up there. Is that a pressure for you? I mean, at the end of the day, the students can only do what they do.
No, it is a pressure. I think when you're driving in, waiting for those results, it's a bit like waiting for the medical test that you don't really want and then hoping it's going to be okay given all the work and everything else. But no, it's also one of the best days actually when you see all of these happy faces. Staff and students actually have all worked extremely hard to get these outcomes in what has been quite a tricky year.
So here at Catmus College, GCSE results day, here with twins. What are your names?
Amelia and Hannah.
What's your surname?
Seymour.
So how is it for you? I mean, you know, I guess you've had this whole journey together, but like anyone, you're individuals.
Yeah, we're both quite competitive, so it was quite scary. The wait for it was the biggest thing though, just the build up, and then actually walking in was kind of okay, and opening them, we opened each other's.
Oh, that's quite nice then.
Yeah, I was no way I was going to be able to open mine, so she opened mine, told me my lowest grade and then my highest grade, and then I did the same for her.
And how was it?
I got 7 A stars, 1 A and a 6 in English Lit, but that's fine.
7 A stars though,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that's good. And yeah, I got 7 A stars and 2 A's.
So are you quite evenly matched then, you two?
Yeah, I would say
which
so.
Which makes us more competitive.
Yeah, I suppose so. So yeah. Are there certain things that, you know, one of you is better at than the other? Is one more arty and one more sciencey? Or?
No, we're both very sciencey.
Yeah, but both of us, we do also like history and philosophy, and we've both like got A stars. So
so where are you both off to next?
Harrington next year.
So the journey will continue. And then what, university together, or will you go?
No, we went to separate.
Yeah, that's the time to make the break.
Yeah, we think so. So I want to do veterinary and Amelia wants to do law. So two different courses at two different universities. So yeah.
Thanks for joining us on this day. What would you say to anyone who's still to collect their results?
You've done your best, so the hard work you put in will show up.
Yeah, now's not when you need the good luck. The good luck is when you did it, so just relax. You've done the best you can do.
Rutland Radio's best bids on the podcast.
Oscar Sutcliffe. I've done really well, I think, like compared
nice
to what I thought I was going to get. So I'm really proud of myself, yeah.
So where are you off to next?
Hopefully the boys' school or Bourne Grammar, I think.
What are you aspiring to be? What's your career goal?
Hopefully an actor.
Madison James.
You've got the highest results in the year group.
I don't know what to say, I'm sorry.
You're really speechless.
I wasn't expecting to do this well, to be honest.
A stars, a B. You've done incredible.
It's really good.
Ewan Brooks.
And you've done super well, haven't you?
Yeah, not too bad.
You're one of the top boys, top performing boys in the year.
Yeah, it's mad.
So what have you got then? Let's have a look.
I got a 7 in maths, 6 in English language, 7 in English literature, an A in drama. It's just something I've always found a passion for, and it's just nice to do something that's not academic as well.
My name's Carl Smith. I'm principal of Casterton College, Rutland.
These are our best ever results, Lydia. They're absolutely fantastic. We're delighted. There was a lot of uncertainty this year because, as many people will be aware, the English and math GCSEs have moved to a 9-to-1 grading system. So there was a lot of doubt and uncertainty about how that would pan out. But in our particular case, it's meant that we've got even better results than we had last year. So we're absolutely delighted.
And what advice would you give to students that might not have got the GCSE grades that they wanted?
Well, the first thing to recognise is that they can, certainly with their English and maths, go again. And in fact, if they don't get a grade 4, the government now requires them to go again. So it's really, really important for whatever career they follow that they make sure that they give their full attention in the forthcoming year to retaking their English and maths again. But there is more choice than ever now. And for young people who haven't done so well and feel like perhaps, you know, they want to improve the grades, well, and I would suggest that first of all, they get a solid year in college or sixth form where they can get a course which will enable them to then make a decision at the end of the year about whether to step up to a higher level apprenticeship or maybe A levels if they prefer that route. So they could look at this year as being a year when they recover their situation. Most important thing is to go to the colleges, go to places like New College Stamford and speak to them. They'll have a team there. Those people will be able to advise you on what courses are available, and from there you can quickly get sorted out. But don't sit on it. Go and speak to the colleges quickly so you can get the whole thing sorted out as soon as you can.
Now, best ever results at Casterton College. So do you have any statistics?
I do. We have 77% of our students who've got the equivalent of a grade C in five subjects, including English and maths or better. So that's an improvement on 73 last year. We were the best in Rutland and Stamford last year. So that's really, really good news. 80% of our students have passed both English and maths, so they've got a grade 4 in both English and maths. We have 88% of our students, nearly 90%, who've got a grade 4 in maths and also or above. And also in English, we have 85% who've got grade 4 or above. So these are really impressive results. One interesting thing, Lydia, is that the new grade 9 has been released for the first time this year. Now, we believe that nationally, only about 2,000 students have received a grade 9 in any subjects. And we're delighted to say that 10 of those come from Casterton. And we have a couple of students who actually got two grade 9s, which is really something very special. Hannah Mahan and Katie Monsour are two students who should be extremely proud having achieved those two grade 9s. And we're very, very pleased for them.
Rutland Radio.
My name's Nick Gallup and I'm headmaster of Stamford School. Around about a quarter of all grades were A-star level. So the guys at the top end have worked incredibly hard and done very well. But right across the board, they've so many boys have exceeded their own expectations and predicted grades by working tremendously over the last few years, supported by some really dedicated staff too.
Have the students done better this year compared to last year? Is there a difference at all?
I think you've always got to balance the performance against their own ability. So as far as value added is concerned, they've done incredibly well, better than previous years. That I suppose is the most important thing, that they have performed according to their own ability or more so. And that's always what we strive for, really, making sure they maximise their own potential. And that will unlock doors into sixth form study and beyond that.
Are there a lot of students staying for sixth form?
Yes, we've got the biggest ever sixth form actually at Stamford School with over 200 across the 2 year groups, which is fantastic news. And of course, last week it was A-level results that we got through. So there's some families that are receiving the second set of grades and results today and very relieved they are to get that out of the way.
Jonty Mason.
Now, you've done super well this year, and you're super tall, actually, just standing next to you. I have to tiptoe to have a look at your results. So let's have a look then. Oh, my gosh, you've got... Tell me what you've got.
I've got 10 A-stars and an A-double-star in further maths.
That is amazing. So many A-stars. I don't think I've ever seen a paper like that. So was it hard work?
I'd say so, yeah. I was panicking a lot during exams, so I was revising loads and loads, but it's all paid off in the end, really.
Yeah, definitely. And you've got a toaster, so can you explain to me about this toaster?
So, basically, our Latin teacher, he's great, called Mr. Blissett, he has a point system like Nectar cards, and basically, if you do well, you get points. And he said, if you get 15,000 points, you get a toaster. So we've all been, saving up all of these points and all of these points. And then he basically made this decision, if we all got A stars, then he'd buy us all toasters.
I've seen another lad with a toaster as well.
Yeah.
The weekly Rutland Radio podcast.
So, Kelsey, it's GCSE results day. Have you been dreading this day?
Yeah, especially on the lead-up, today.
It's quite nerve-wracking, isn't it? It feels like a really big day. You've already got your results, yeah. So how have you done?
I've done really well. The grades are a bit low compared to what you were predicted, but we are the first year for some of it, so it's a bit difficult.
Yeah, are you doing the is it the 1 to 9?
Yeah, in English and maths. So yeah.
So was that a bit confusing at first?
Yeah, for the lead up for the past 2 years, it's been stressing everyone out.
Yeah, but are you happy with the outcome?
Yes, very happy. Hard work pays off.
George Edwards Morris. I got the grades I needed. I needed 5 B's to A's, and I got that. And I got an 8 in English Lit, 1 mark off a 9. And English Lit is the subject that I want to be taking at A-levels, so yeah, it went pretty well.
Highlights from the past 7 days, the Rutland Radio podcast.
My name's Tracy Spring, and I'm the Membership and Marketing Manager at Rutland County Golf Club.
So, foot golf. Explain it to me, because I was quite confused when I first heard of it.
Basically, what it is, it's combining the two most popular sports in the world, really, coming together, golf and football. So basically, it doesn't cost anything too much because they've got any equipment. They kick a football into a hole, but it's 21 inches in diameter, so it's the same sort of distance as in relation to the golf hole. And basically, it's a person who gets around in the shortest number of kicks around the 9-hole course that we've got here. So it's great fun for all ages, any ability, female, men, everything. It's really good fun for everybody.
And do you do it here quite often then?
We've had the course open for about a year, but we've now just gone into relationship with UK Foot Golf, which is the association which have tournaments all over the world. So we're hoping to push it further and with the local community.
So how can people get involved? Do you have particular foot golf sessions on particular days?
We don't at the moment, but it is something that we're looking at, maybe doing some holiday clubs with foot golf. But they can just come up. We're open 7 days a week from 8 o'clock in the morning through till 6:30 at night. So they can just come up, go out with their friends. So it's that kind of thing, really.
And there's quite a lot of people here today for the launch.
Yeah, we're lucky to be supported by the Young Daniels in Stamford. They got a big group together for us, another local sort of children and parents and that in the area that have played a little bit and wanted to join in.
Well, that's it for this week's Rutland Radio podcast. If you have any comments, you can email us via the website rutlandradio.co.uk, and we'll have a new version on our website from Monday.
This is a download from Rutland Radio. For more information, go to rutlandradio.co.uk. Okay.